Well, you are more experts in sovereign money and so on, because I have only 3 years reading of that. But I think I am an expert in the current system, and I know very well the problems of the current monetary and banking system. Because when I was appointed governor, where we had an excellent system, the best of the Europe and so on, and it exploded, and then I know what are the costs, not just budgetary. In Spain, 10 years now after the crisis, we have not got the same level of employment, and they have destroyed families a lot, and the cost of the banking crisis is terrible. And I've seen all the problems of our system. We had previously a tremendous real estate bubble. The prices grow 140% and so on. Then I know perfectly what are the problems we have, and I discovered this 4 years ago, 5 years ago, reading your books, or Ben Dyson, especially on positive money. No? When positive money was focused on this question, now they are focusing in other question, very respectable, but not really in the question of the change of the system. And then what I can tell you is that what I lack when I try to read about this, what I lack to converse and to look for arguments and so on. And one is that I think there is too much, and of course it's important, this question of stability. Current money is fragile, deposit money, deposit in the central bank CBDC are very safe, and you don't have bubbles, and you get seniorage, and on all these kinds of things. But I lack, I think we lack what happens if you get sovereign money, at the same time you destroy banks as they are now. Not just, they destroy, they cannot function. I mean, when I see sometimes, well, and the banks will be, no, the banks will not exist as they are. Because they are doing something now that is transforming the mismatching, no? Of the different, that you cannot do that if you don't have a lot of protection by the state. And if you have an asset that is a money that is safe, you don't need to provide by the state insurance deposits, blah, 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 resort. They don't get the seniorage, that is a good subsidy. They can bankrupt, why we are going to have a system, a special system bankruptcy. You will apply to all institutions competition and antitrust law, because now you don't apply that. I mean, we have a merger here from the Santander and the Popular, the first and the fourth, and nobody said nothing, and probably competition in the EU, in the European Union, will not say nothing with Deutsche Bank and Commerzbank. And then they are completely with a lot of protectionism. There is no other sector, not in the real economy, not in the financial sector, because no part of the financial sector has all this of protections, liquidity. A hedge fund, they don't have any protection with the finance as guaranteed by the state to the zero cost. They don't have liquidity support. They don't have. They can be bankrupt, Amaranta and many banks and so on. Then the amount of protection is enormous, and you lose all the justification for that, because if you have money, why are you going to protect the banks as a special time? Then that's, I think, in really now, our money, our current money, is completely interlinked with banking activities. Banks is money and banking activities, lending and payment services. And then when you get a safe money, you disentangle this. And then why to protect this? If you, they can be provided by the market. And by the market means not by the banks, because you would have many possibilities to provide, especially in the digital way. No? It's the same as when I was young, a long time ago, when you wanted to make a travel, you had to go to the travel agency to buy the tickets from the train and the plane, and you got a hotel with a bonus from the hotel in the travel agency. But you could do that without going to the travel agency. I mean, you could buy directly the internet tickets from the plane and from the train, and you could get through Booking or other platform without needing a travel agency. Travel agencies exist, but just for riches and for all people that don't know how to. Then that the 90% of the lending will be provided by other platforms and other that now they cannot compete because banks are protected. One of the reasons. I mean, I don't understand how the fintech, like Lending Club and other, could provide $20 billion of lending. That is nothing but without competition with the bank. Because if they want to get financing, they have to go there to you and say, give me 10,000 euros and I will lend. But if you have a bank, you have at least 30% of your financing guaranteed by the state at zero cost. Now, well, 0.5 when you want. Then my idea is that it is important also to focus in the enormous protection that have the banks now. Why? Because I think people could understand well that it's important to save money and so on and so on, but they could understand also why we need to protect the banks. Because you are spending a lot of money in that. You are spending the seniors. You are spending the what is the cost of the insurance deposit? What is the cost of the lending to banks and so on and so on? This is an enormous amount of money to protect. Why? Now it's clear. If you don't have that, you don't have money. I mean, it's totally justified, this protection now. If you don't change that, when I talk with some, because I injected capital and money in many Spanish banks and say, well, you are saying that it is possible to not inject money in the banks if you have sovereign money. Okay, but why did you inject this capital? Because if you have the private bank money, you need to inject capital, you need to help banks. And if you don't do that, you are full, because that will collapse more than with our current crisis. Then my first idea that I would like to transmit is look and study what happens with banks. And that, the second idea is that that's why it's very important the transition. I think, well, most of people will understand that at the final stage, sovereign money is a good system and so on, you have deposits, very sure and so on, and the lending is provided by many actors, many agents, service payments, payment services, excuse me, could be provided by many actors and so on, and this is working very well. But the problem is how we go from here to here. Mm-hmm. And that's, I must confess that none of the transition that I've seen, just now Lars explained one, no? And Edgar will explain this evening. No, I don't understand that, but I think you have a system of transition. But I don't think that we have, or at least I have not read a good transition. Then that is my idea. And this is very important because, well, shareholders of banks, people that work there, I mean, government that are financed by banks, want to know what is going to happen, not just with money, but with lending activities. No, it's the famous sentence of Bill Gates, that probably is not from Bill Gates, as all words, is we need banking, but we don't need banks anymore. But we need banking, we need lending, we need payment services. Then that's why we should study what happens with the other part, not just money, but all the services that have to continue to be provided, and how you go from this to the other situation. No? And then, but at the same time, I think I see other idea that it could be contradictory, and is the following. Thinking in the Swiss experiment, there are one here, no? Yes. One of the problems, and now I'm entering in a territory that I don't know very well, because it's the territory of the reformers, of the activists. I am not an activist, I am not a reformer, then probably I will say things that, but I could give you my idea, is that the idea of the Swiss referendum is to present a very serious problem of reform. I mean, that 20 or 30 pages of Folger and so on and so on and so on. Then, with there, you open many possibilities to criticize that, because there are many details. What, how is it to go to, what is going to do the central bank, that stabilization, what is going to do? Then, from the point of view, I am asking for more study to the bank part, the banking part, but if I see the problem from the activist, we should go to a very simple questions and allow others to complement that. Then my ideal referendum, I don't think this is going to be solved by referendum. I think it's, we have to do many things and not just a referendum. But the problem will be, well, we have now deposits in the banks that are fragile. And the deposits in the bank are, in the central bank, are sure. And they don't need, and you explain, they don't need a bank and so on. Then the question is, why don't we allow the Swiss citizens to have accounts in the central bank? You want, yes or not? And then that is something that opened the possibility to do many things there. And in that sense, I think that the question of opening the possibility to have deposits in the bank is very important. Why? For instance, the e-krona. The e-krona is not central bank digital currency, but this is a certain central bank digital currency. Then, for the first time, you are going to have a wallet. You are not going to have the possibility to have accounts in the Central Bank of Sweden, but you are going to have central bank digital currencies. Same and so on. Then that's a possibility. And when if you have this wallet of safe money, because it's very small but it's safe money, people would see, and why not the other deposits? I mean, why I have right to have central bank money as tokens or as wallet, but not deposit? Then I think it's important. And now in the States, for me, it's fantastic what has happened with the narrow bank that has been proposed to the Federal Reserve. I don't know if most of you know this question. I could explain what has happened. Well, how this has happened. Well, 3 years ago, the chief economist of the Federal Reserve of New York, that is the tool that used the Federal Reserve to operate in the as they are decentralized in any central bank. In the Bank of Spain, we have operation inside the central bank of Spain, but in the United States, the operation of the market and so on is in the Federal Reserve in New York. It's not in Washington. Well, the chief economist of this Federal Reserve left the bank, left the Federal Reserve, and created a bank that was authorized by the Connecticut State. There you would have a license from the Connecticut State.
What's the name?
The name is curious, because it's TNB. Excuse me, TNB, the Narrow Bank.
Narrow
Bank. Then the bank is the. And they got the license, and they said, well, what I am going to do with this bank? Just I will take the money of the clients and I will put in the account of the Federal Reserve. I'm not going to lend, I'm not going to do anything. Then it's 100% sure. Then, and then what happens? Happens that they ask to the Federal Reserve of New York the license to operate, to open and so on. And the Federal Reserve of New York didn't answer, and didn't answer, and didn't answer. And then he asked it, because he had relation, and asked it, who happens? Nobody tell me nothing, they don't give me the license, but they don't deny and so on, I can't do anything. And they went, as is usual in the United States, fortunately, to the court. And then the Federal Reserve don't give me an answer, and I cannot operate. I have a bank, it's so. Well, and then this idea was leaked by Bloomberg with a title, because he discovered that the Federal Reserve didn't want to do that because they were afraid that many people would go there. Well, there in the United States you have more incentives to do that. The incentive is that the Federal Reserve since 2008 pay Federal Reserves, and they pay now 2.4%. That is an enormous amount. I mean, nobody pays you 2.54% for a deposit, no? And then and the business is clear, no? You pay 1.4 and you take 1%, and then it's fantastic business. Well, and then they detected that Jerome Powell, the Fed chairman, said, well, that's not possible, we cannot allow to operate, and then he went to the court. And Blumenthal discovered that and published an article, I think it was Matt Levin, that said the Federal Reserve denied operate to the most sure banks in the United States. Then you don't allow to operate to the most safe bank in the United States. Well, and last week, because the theme is fascinating, the Federal Reserve has announced a public notice with a change in the system of payment of reserves. And then, first interesting thing, they don't prohibit operation. They are going to allow to operate because they see the problems that they should not allow, if they don't allow to operate to the narrow bank. But they propose to pay the usual banks 2.4%, but the narrow bank or similar banks close to zero. They don't say the amount, but you could think that they are going to pay zero. Well, that has been fantastic. I mean, I don't know if you know the Cochrane, that is an American economist, very good economist, excellent economist, too free market economy, and he wrote it 2 days ago, a paper, demolishing the decision of the Federal Reserve, no? Because the idea was, well, it is very difficult to justify, if this bank is very sure and is not going to cost to the taxpayers, they don't need insurance deposits, they don't need lending reserves, you never will inject capital taking money from the taxpayers, and you are going to pay nothing, and if you others go to a bank that is going to have a risky asset, and you will need the second deposit, and those are going to pay more. Well, it could be the opposite. I mean, if you want a sure bank, you should pay more to the people that put the deposits and with the taxpayers. Well, at the end, what I want to say is that the idea to enter in the deposits of the central bank is, from the point of view, if I were an activist, I will try to start with that and concentrate with that, because once you enter, you oblige the others the burden of the proof. They have to say, no, I don't allow you to have deposits here. And not like at this moment that we have to defend the virtues of the new system. the virtues and so on and say, well, no, I'm going to detect that these problems of the new system. No, no, you have to show clearly the problems of protection of the current system, not the new system. I mean, that is the small contribution of a non-activist, but I think it's very important. And going back and finishing, you know, the banks, it's very important that for other reason, studying the banks and what is going to happen with the bank in a sovereign money. The idea that you could liberalize and deregulate an activity and reduce protection, have many people that like that. I mean, there are many people on the right, but on the left, and then that also that believe in a free international trade, that they like what has happened with telecommunication, liberalizing and reducing the protection, and having then the idea of liberalizing a sector and introducing competition, because now they don't have competition and so on, and increasing efficiency, is an idea that is not bad, and should not be bad, in my view, also from the leftist population, because of the leftist electors. Why? Because in fact, when you have a banking system, or no banking system, banking activities, lending and payment services under competition, you are gaining efficiency and you are gaining resources, because the state is getting more resources, more growth, less subsidies, then the state, the public, is getting more resources. What the subsidies now are being used for subsidizing debt and profits of the banking, but in general subsidizing debt, but whatever is the debt. I mean, you are subsidizing real estate speculation, you are subsidizing travels for rich people and so on and so on. If you allow the lending to the market, of course you could not like the result, and you could think you are green, or you are a social democrat, and you think you should reduce inequality and so on. But you could use those resources from the state directly, not affecting the money, not using the money and the banking system, but you could subsidize green investment, you could guarantee loans to poor people and so on, but not mixing with the money. The problem with what I see in the current system with the proposals to more green or less inequality and so on, is that not changing the system, you are not getting what you want, because you are having a system that is bad, that is fragile, and so on and so on. And if you try to, with the current system, to divert resources to green and so on, probably you are increasing fragility and you are doing very bad things. But if you have the security and you have the confidence that money is not affected with interventions, targeted interventions in the market, that should better, because the resources are enormous. Put Linus, put the slide that I used to put, because I think we don't have any idea of the enormous protections that current banks have. And
still giving on.
Yeah, I think it turned off because
it needs
to
yeah.
Oh, it's coming.
No, to see, yes, yes. And to finish, and we open the liberty. Well, I have here the all privileges, protections, subsidies, because it's very good. Well, the most important prohibition, the most important protection, is what I call the prohibitions. Only banks can hold current accounts of the central bank. I mean, that is really the most important. That's why I think it's the most important from the point of view to reform, open the possibility that the central bank deposits are open to everybody, with caps, with whatever you want and so on. But that is the most important, because if we have this prohibition, the citizen cannot have the possibility to go and to shift from fragile bank to a secure or safe central bank. Then that is the most important. And that's why I put there. And the rest is, once you have, with this prohibition, get that all the population have their money in fragile banks, because it's the objective of this prohibition is all population have to have their money in unsafe banks. This is the objective. Then, and once you have unsafe banks, even that, you need to protect those unsafe banks. And what are the protection? You have a protectionist regulatory block. Without protections, fragile money, without this protection, will not exist. I mean, you have many sectors with a lot of protection, like agriculture and others and so on. If you take out all the protections, you will have many farms and agricultures that they could not get profits, they will close and so on. But you will have a lot of agriculture that will survive. If you don't have that, no bank will survive. All the profits of the banks comes from the protectionism of the state. For sure, no. If you take out that, no bank subsists. No bank, impossible. Because who is going to put their money if you don't have warranty? If you know that you are going to have problems of liquidity and they cannot sell that bank the assets and so on, impossible. That is the other important, liquidity support. And we are providing liquidity support not in small things. To save the banks, before I leave from as governor of the central bank, I approved what was called the LTRO, long-term liquidity support. But the small amount of 800,000 million euros, is an amount really no sector, no enterprise, no entity in the investment sector, hedge fund or so or financial fund, could get that amount of liquidity. That is incredible. And after I left, they provided long-term, targeted long-term, asking to the banks to provide credit and so on. The capital injection, not only you have problems of liquidity, if you became insolvent, you get capital injection from the tax base. In Spain, we provided 40,000 billion euros. That is 4% of GDP. That is an enormous amount of money. Well, that you could do many, many things. They cannot follow the bankruptcy law. You have a special resolution. No other entity in the financial system have a special resolution that you have to help. That is a terrible protection, because that is against the market. I mean, all sectors in the market functions if you have an entry and exit without problems. And sometimes we look of the entry problems, no? You could create a bank and so on. But no, the problem is that to have a good market in any sector and function in other market, what is important is that when you are doing the things bad and you don't get profit, you go out and you disappear. But the problem here is that we should continue with zombie banks inside other banks and so on, because we cannot allow that they leave the market. Then this is very destructive on the market.
Deutsche Bank is the best example.
Well, it's best example, yes. Yes, but now in the States, the last year in the United States, and you will know where, we had at least 20 bankruptcies of textile business, Gap, Sears, and so on. Well, that's normal. And others enter Walmart, Amazon, and so on, and then it's how you get the low prices for everybody, because that the market have enormous advantages for usual people, because you don't pay the high prices and you don't pay. But here, no, you have to continue inside others for integration and so on with the bad people. But there is no other solution. I continue. You don't have, you have the current system that is very good. I mean, I don't say that this is very necessary. And then the digital scenarios, no? That was a calculation, no? A person in Denmark that calculated for the Bank of for England 22 billion pounds or something like that. Then it's some amount that is not similar. Well, the curious thing is that even if you protect that, or perhaps because you protect too much, the banks take a lot of risk, and they are become risky. And then we approve a prudential regulatory block. In this sense, this prudential is not to protect, is something the opposite. You cannot provide a mortgage without putting 50% of capital. You cannot do, lend to a small and medium enterprise, and so on and so on. Well, this is something that I did. I collaborated when I in 2009. When after the crisis, Obama and other leaders decide to create the G20, and the G20 create the Financial Stability Board. That the message of the leaders was after the crisis, this cannot happen again. Please change the rules and so on. And then, and I took part in the steering committee of the FSB, and we. And we built what is called Basel III, and so on and so on. And it's a lot of interventionism. Capital and liquidity requirement, anti-cyclical market, remuneration, exposure. None of these regulations are applied to any other entity of the financial system. No hedge fund, no financial fund, no investment funds, and so on. It's terrible. It's terrible because this means that the banks now cannot do anything. I mean, they are completely asphyxiated, and that's a problem. Because if they fulfill with that, you have a problem. If they don't fulfill, they have risk and they could fail. Then it's a situation very, very terrible. No? And it's incredible. I mean, somebody calculate once we are approved in Basel, this prudential block was to the capitals, to the nations, and in Europe was converted in the capital directive, and in the United States in the Dodd-Frank law, more or less. Well, if you take any of them, because they are similar in size, any of them have, with all the developments, all the decrees and so on, 10,000 pages. That means 2 million words. And to have an idea, the Bible, have 700,000 words. Then it's 3 Bibles. If you want to, if a banker or a supervisor, as I want to read one style, need to read 3 Bibles. That do not happen in any other sector. In any other sector. I mean, it's incredible. Well, and in addition to that, competition and antitrust are not enforced. We are going to see next week in the Deutschland. And you have also created an enormous public institutions, supervisors that you will need, because you will need, you don't have supervisors of hedge fund and so on, central banks because you have to lend, and so on and so on. And many macroprudential supervision. If you see the map of institutions created in Europe and more in the United States, it's incredible. Then all this is very important to take into account when we are talking about reform money, because if we reform money and we have, why we have that? Because money now is a financial asset. It's not money. Money is not last. I will correct your because you say when you say the in the banks you put money, no, the money of the private banks is not money. It's a promise to pay money because it's not money, because money is something that do not change. The banknote, 50 euros. This is 50 euros. 50 euros in a bank is 50 euros or 45. I mean, it's not, no, it's, I remember Thomas
Dyer. The exchange is 1-to-1.
Eh?
The exchange is 1-to-1.
Parity.
So parity.
Well, I don't want to spend more time. I give you two or three ideas seen from an observer, because in my view, no, to finish, I'm not a reformer, I am an observer. I think that what is going to be the future of the money and the reform? I don't see that a reform will be possible. I think that will result from cracks from the current system, and that's why it's very important to me to concentrate the idea in the deposit of the central bank. The rest are secondary in relation with the deposit of the central bank. Because what is in my view the problem of the banks now? They are going to have serious problems of getting profits. I mean, with this enormous regulation, with the competition from fintechs, that they are going to take the best of their business, and so on, we are going to see that they are going to be. Then I see that the reaction of central bankers or supervisors, the central bankers or supervisors, we were completely focused on the profits of the banks. Well, we are the guardians. We are not the police of the banks. We are the guardians. Why? And that's justified. Because if banks lose this, we are going to have a problem. Because the first line of defense of a crisis is the profits. It's the first moment. And then what is going to happen? That the banks are going to have problems. And they are not going to get profits. And they are going to get and ask supervisor and central bankers to give more protection that could be 800,000 millions of lending or whatever, on supervisor limiting this regulation and reducing the regulation. But if you reduce regulation, you increase the risk, and that the probability to have crisis, it will be more important. Well, I finish.
Miguel.
This plan of opening current accounts with central banks on the part of the citizens is implemented. What happens to the banks if there is the feeling that there is a forthcoming financial crisis and everybody will just open accounts, will take money out from the private banks and put it in the central banks? The private banks will disappear as well. They all go back.
Well, there are some ideas. In fact, that is a problem of transition. That's why I think we should think a lot on transition, because the benefits of the system, are obvious benefits of stability, and obvious benefits of competition, innovation, and all these questions. I mean, the efficiency of the system. But how to go to, and that's one problem. Well, I am continuing to see. The last thing that I saw is similar to what was indicated by Ben Dyson and what has presented Lars today, that the central bank learned, no? And I want to know the idea of the government. No? The central bank compensate the deposits, the running deposits, no? And then you could avoid a crisis with this question, no? But it's not so clear, because why the central bank? What is going to happen today with your exposition, Lars? What are the incentives of one bank that you say that you give them a loan and they have the asset to manage the assets and to repay the loans? And what are the incentives for the institution, no? I mean, I think there are many, many things that, at least I don't know, probably have been studied by others, but if any of you could tell me, well, there is a very good idea of transition, tell me. I know, well, the positive money, no? The two possibilities, others, and I am looking forward to listen to Edgar to today, because the WWR is in Dutch and I don't know Dutch, then I have not read the report.
Thank you so much. I have two questions. First, I think this perfectly summarizes the craziness of the current system and how they built layer and layer on top to heal a completely broken system. But if you see it, it's like so obvious, but why are there so few central bankers like you who support us? I feel they are outside the level 5.
It's a very easy question. Why? Because if you don't change, if money is deposits in the private banks, you need that and more.
But why don't they see out of the box?
Well, because as far as we are using this like money, I mean, this is necessary.
Right.
If you don't change money, and you say that you don't need to inject capital in the banks, you don't need the central banks allowing 800,000 euros, you are full. This is completely justified. And then my central bankers, when they say that, and I finish when I wrote in different things, I always say, and while we don't have a safe money, we don't need that. I mean, that has been, you are a historian, that has been a long history, because if you see, for instance, one of the things that I think we did not correct is that we asked for capital requirement an increase very, very limited. I mean, if you compare the total assets of a bank, not the risk weight assets, that is a space of formula to say that, with the equity, before the crisis in Europe, the average were less than 2%.
Yeah.
98 were the others' money. That's the title of the keyboard. And in the United States was more or less than 3%. Well, the European Banking Agency last year decided that at least the European banks have to have 3%. That means that if we get that, 97% in Europe will be the fragility is enormous, because if the assets lose in Europe, they have 3% of equity, lose 5%, they are
all banks.
Banks, because that is an average. There are some banks that have 8% and others that not, no?
Yeah,
not all banks, but a few, a great quantity. In the United States, has been 5, because they are more serious than the Europeans, and they have, they put 5. 95%? Then there are many academics, especially Anata Mati that from Stanford, that published an excellent book that is the Banker's New Process, where she explained that to have a less frequency of banking crisis, less severity and so on, should have 25%. Mm-hmm. But more interesting in the United States, Neil Kashkari. Neil Kashkari was was in the Republican when the last time of Bush, and was the person that was in charge of nationalizing the 6 big banks with the TARP, that was hundreds of thousands of dollars nationalizing the banks. And last year he's now president of the Federal Reserve of Minneapolis, and produces a paper that calculating probabilities and no and so on and so on, they said that we need a 30-35% of capital. We have 35%. Oh. And what happens? That even if most academic and economists are asking for more capital, for instance, Sacchetti, that was chief economist of the BIS and so on, it's impossible because the banks cannot get that amount of capital because people wants to put a small amount of capital because if things go well you gain a lot, but if not you lose just 3%. But if you put 30% and the things go wrong, you lose a lot because you are going to pay that. From the point of view of supervisors, a great amount of equity and capital is good, but the point of view of the investor, no. I mean, as small is the amount of capital you put, is better for you. Then this is impossible. And let me say the historical question. It's curious because the market regulate better than the technocrats and the state now. Because if you see in the 19th century, that happens two things. One that I think is very important to from the activist point of view, and is the how the banknotes were converted in safe money. I mean, because in the 19th century, all the banks notes, most of the banknotes were private, and you have a lot of crises, small crises and so, but a lot. And with the Peel Law in 1844, was decided that all the banknotes will be safe and will be public. And now the sovereign money is the same with deposits. It's the same. The comparison, I think, is very good, and many people understand when I explained it. Understand very well the idea because well you have an unsafe money, a fragile money, and you now nobody is afraid about the problem that when he goes to the big note of 50 euros is not going to have. No, then that is one important thing, and then you don't have many of this protection. You don't have that. You don't have deposit insurance. The liquidity support was very limited. You don't have Federal Reserve or central banks, banks. And what happens? That the capital ratio were not 3% like in Europe, what 5%, was between 30 and 40%. Because the market regulated better, because people say, I don't put money in a bank if you don't have 30% or 40% of market. And now, with all this protection, you are destroying the possibility that the market discipline the entities.
Fully.
Because I don't know if I can say
a really, really short question. You already touched upon it, and you talked about it, that you are talking about these topics. Are you, as with your profession and with your expertise, now putting this forth to other people and to other people that are possibly in charge of deciding over these topics? So are you taking these presentations and go out to other leaders and try to show them? Because I think yes, this would be very important.
That's the core of my presentation, my best, what I think I could provide to your movement and so on is this, I mean, focus on banking and the protection, not only protection, the interventionist, because this can be understood for many economists, that they are not aware about that. I mean, it's curious, no? I were not, when I was governor, aware that we had the most intervened and protected sector. I thought it was, there are some competition, there are some banks, and so on, and so on. No, well, and that's sometimes it's an answer in some presentation. Well, if you could go to a bank and another, yes, but you go from this fragile money to this fragile money. I mean, you have an excellent competition.
Other question.
Sorry.
You describe.
May I interrupt you? There are two hands, and women are not talking much in this day. So I would like them to speak.
I have three questions. Could we
live
without money? Is there a way for the education? What are the main purpose of the money? Second question, do we need one, two, three multiple unit of measure as
unit of
like euro, dollar, yen, power, the governor of the central bank, the president Macron, the commission of Europe. Who have power?
Who have?
Yes.
Well, we know. I mean, you stand with the. It's a question, right? As the president and the government.
Who has the power?
The political power have Macron and the governor.
So.
The governor of the Bank of France have very few powers now. Mm-hmm. Because as the governor of the Bank of Spain, I mean, monetary policy is done by the ECB. He has a post, of course, he's a member as I was the governing council, but among 27 people. And the central, the Bank of France, the central Bank of France, do not have yet the supervisory power that we had, at that time. No? Then the central bank, this central bank in France. The other question was the first, we could live without money, yes, but very bad. Very bad. Because money is very important, no? And I think in history there are very few populations without very few populations without any kind of money. You know? And the second one was.
Do we need a multiple money currency?
It's what we have. The good thing of the idea of sovereign money is that, in my view, do not try to change everything. I mean, no, to change money and so on and so on. And then, well, we have the Swedish krona. That's not bad. No? I think sometimes when I saw, for instance, what we did in Brussels, in Basel, always I thought about the advantages to the international cooperation, thinking together, deciding together, but there is a problem because we decided together, in my view, a terrible thing instead, because the group thinking, no? The idea that you don't have, sometimes decentralization and having different possibilities give you could get more fresh ideas if you have decentralization. And then I think that it's good, for instance, now the ECB has not done anything about this question, but the Swedish bank that is not in the euro has done. And the banks of the Eurozone has done nothing, I mean, and the Bank of England, the Swedish bank, then I am more favorable of have different currencies.
But are Swedish banks with a cashless society not vulnerable to digital hackers and, you know, money in the world that runs around on computers?
Well, I am going to profit your question because my idea about your question is that we have that problem, whatever is the system, and then you could solve, and the problem of privacy. There are many problems that
are the same way you bank have.
And let me profit this opportunity because you talk about the cash when last said, and I have my position about the cash is that it is important because you say, well, even if there is no intervention of the state, no problem because that cash is going to disappear. I see a problem. Because cash is the only public and safe money that we have. If you don't substitute by digital public cash, you are forced to have cash fragile money. I mean, a fragile money. Then that's why I think it's very important the initiative of the Swedish bank. Because you are substituting physical cash that is public and is safe by digital cash that is safe and is public. But if you don't do nothing, all the cash is going to be in the bank, in the private banks, and it's going to be fragile, and you are going to have problems. That is my position. And the other position is that you should not as Kenneth Rojo of Anadas proposed to suppress cash. because at least in Spain, I don't know in Sweden, but in Spain there are many people, old people, poor people that use cash. And why you don't, what is the problem of a small cash? I mean, the big cash, of course, you have the big denomination problem and whatnot. I don't see any problem.
So we've got about 10 more minutes for questions. So we've got one, two, and three.
Sue's had her hand up for ages.
Are there
safe banks? Do they exist? Like, what
you mentioned? Well, I don't know the level of safety of the banks or the level. What I think is that in this question that we are dealing today, that is changed from private deposit to public deposit, we are going to have the same problem, and probably you will need decentralization to avoid the problems of cyber attacks and so on inside the central bank. I don't know the solution. It's a technical solution, and I don't know what to say about that.
Sure.
Hi. My question has to do with central bank digital currencies being introduced while we still have this two-circuit system of reserves in the central bank and bank money in our banks, right? So if customers of the bank say, I'm going to move my account to the central bank, if it's a small bank, the reserves go to the central bank and out of the small bank. Maybe they can deal with that. But if it's a big bank, and I worked for a big bank for 16 years in New York, the corporate customers have big accounts. They get a lot of benefits. They get a lot of different sweeps, overseas sweeps with their money. They're not going to get that from the central bank, so their money is going to stay in the big banks, where the powers, the owners of the system, of the big banks in the U.S.
I'm not quite. First, it's a problem of transition. We have to start. That's my answer is that we, but the more important question that you say, a different behavior of, if I understood, of big companies and so on, and they could not be interested in using the central bank digital currencies and so on, because they could, in my first reaction is the opposite. I mean, one of the advantages, for instance, of the narrow band that I explained, is that you have, in the state, you have the insurance deposit in 100 euros, $100 before the crisis, and now they, it's incredible, they increase the protection to $250. Well, many corporations have enormous amounts of millions that they would like not to have in a bank that could fail. The main business would be to avoid the problem, so that over 250 euros, the 7 million and 10 million is going to suffer. Then I don't see, but I have not thought a lot about that.
Klaus?
We had in Germany in the 70s, in the last century, there was a member of the board of the government, of the Deutsche Bundesbank, and he retired. And then he published a book, Critical Thoughts about the National International Monetary System. It was very near to sovereign money. And
who was?
He's
Klaus Koch.
Rolf Koch. Rolf Koch, you don't know him, but we know him very well. Even you met him once, huh?
Yes.
Yeah. But he was completely excommunicated from the financial family, central bankers, and so. What's happening to you now?
Transition. You cannot. First, I have a lot of friends among bankers, because I spend among bankers, among central bankers, and they continue to have friends, and I explain, and they say, well, that it will take 2 centuries and so on. But one idea to not be excommunicated is what I decided, because I started to see this, and I wanted to think freely. And I decided not to be in that community. I mean, all my friends that we were members of the governing council are members or presidents of the banks. Axel Weber is president of Swiss, a Swiss bank. Vinnie Snaghi, that was Italian, is the president of BNP. Members of the board, the two Hispanias, Caruana and González Páramo, and members of the board of the Bilbao Vizcaya. I only live with my savings and my public pension. Then they cannot discriminate. I mean, no, yeah.
I'm Stephen from the United States, and I'm working on monetary reform and working on education. And one of the problems we have is when the United States is the reserve currency internationally, it's such a big player, and all that money, more money's abroad than in the States. How do I make the US dollar just a national currency? And what do we do internationally? And should there be a new money for international purposes? And any strategies you may have for a reform of the United States, I would appreciate them.
Well, one of the things that I have not studied, I mean, the first answer could be the international exchange. I will allow to the market. I mean, I have our currency, and if anybody could change euros for dollars, but others, I will give to the market. But it's a relatively easy answer. I have not devoted time to that question. I think we should study what to do. But my idea in general is that the interventions and so on from the part of one or the central bank should disappear, because my idea of the central bank digital currency is that the central bank will not be a central bank. We don't need to have sovereign money, a bank. We don't need that they lend to anybody. My idea of the issuer is something that I studied, is a register. I mean, the idea is the register of the, we have in Spain, I suppose, in many countries, the register of real property. Real property. Well, the register is a public agency that register and say this goes from this to this, this goes from this to this. But the property is from the citizens. Then the sovereign money, in fact, is one. Is why I don't use in Spain sovereign money, because it gives the idea that it's the money for the sovereign. That in reality, it's the people's money. Some yes. More populist. Yes. The problem is that some more populist, and I don't like populism. but really, it's the citizens. I mean, because you increase, you decide, you have the governing council, and you decide and increase. Here is the problem, where the seniors goes, citizens or whatever and so on. But once you have created, that is not a liability of the bank. It's an asset from the people, and the people decide then if they want to change the euro forever, and they will do. I will not change, I will not lend. I don't have a balance sheet. That is one of the problems I have explaining to economists that are all the day. Well, how is possible? Money is always a liability. No. Money could be something that is not a liability of nothing. Of nobody, no?
Experts. I know of the stock market, as a supervisor of the stock market, I know some people, they don't know how it works. And my question is, how is the level in central bankers or bankers in general of the understanding, of the real understanding of the monetary system? Here are, and my second question is, in Spain there was a committee in the parliament they investigated all what was happening across the crisis. What was the result of this commission?
Very interesting, because well, the reality is what you describe. I mean, the usual people is not interested, and so on and so on. That's very interesting. But that's very interesting. Why? And it's because of the positive influence. I mean, when we say Thomas Mayer in Frankfurt says, we don't have a monetary union, we have a cash union, because people have. But it's not the same, the deposit in Greece, in Germany, or in this bank or the other. But that is true, is not true from the point of view of the customer, because it's the same. I mean, if I have warranty, then it has a anesthesia, how do you say in English, anesthesia?
Anesthesia
of the people, because they don't see that this system have a problem. I have my money, I get my money, if you fail the state debt, then it has a terrible that, because you are avoiding that the market works, because if you have millions of people worry about the deposit, then they will be sure. You take out the deposit and you will see how the people react. But that has an anesthetic effect that, well, that's a problem of the politicians or whatever. Or
yeah, but that's a lie. That's a lie that the deposit guarantee is sufficient to cover up to 100,000. It's a big lie.
It's warranty. The problem
no,
is that...
No. No. In Switzerland we saw it, 6 billion of guarantee versus 800 billion.
No, well, one question is that the deposit insurance do not work and you don't need other. But from the point of view of the customer is that, in fact, the deposit insurance has not applied in any country during the crisis. Why? Because if you have a big bank, and the best of insurance deposit takes 2 days, 3 days, 5 days. Do you imagine if you have the customers of the Deutsche Bank 5 days without money? Then what do you do is an integration or injection of capital or whatever. And then the deposit insurance has not been used. And of course, if the deposit insurance you want to be used, is what you say, in Spain, I think they have 3 billion euros and is 1 trillion. But there are all other things in your question that is curious, because the authorities. Why the authorities, the central bankers, do not think in that? Well, that was
my case.
That was my case. I mean, and I would tell you one thing: the tyranny of the problems you have on the table. I mean, what do we have now? If I were now governor and member of the center, I were thinking of what is going to happen with the Deutsche Bank and so on and so on and so on. Please tell me a little another moment about CBDC. The other problem is, no, the other problem is true. I mean, you have that responsibility. And you have the problem of the deceleration. And what we do? We inject additional money, we do that. Quantitative easing, it doesn't work, and we are thinking in question that with the current money are crucial. And you don't have time or interest in other alternatives. I mean, you should understand. I'm very sympathetic with my colleagues.
The Commission really had an interest in knowing what was going on.
Well, but it's the same. The Commission is thinking in that. And in some question also, they are trying to do is to use the current system to do things green or whatever and so on, but without changing the system. And the other question that you mentioned, we had in Spain a commission to investigate and so on and to see what happened with our financial system, our banking system, in the parliament, and. As we are, that happens in the United States 6 months after the crisis. In Spain, it was 8 years after the crisis. But that's no problem. And they started and they finished and I went. I spent four hours and a half talking. about what happened with this bank and those banks. And I end my statement and my intervention saying, and I think you should study possibilities of change the system, because there are many people, just was less than 1 minute.
It's on YouTube.
I was in YouTube,
it's on YouTube.
I was in my world, and so on, and so on, and so on. But well, they have done nothing. I mean, the interests of politicians were the new parties that have not in charge of the crisis to attack, no? Especially Demos and Ciudadanos say, well, you did it very bad, and so on and so on. And the Popular Party that was a little in charge was attacked the Socialist Party, because some part was in charge of Socialist Party. And the Socialist Party, that is curious, attacked the Popular Party, but also the members of the Socialist Party that were in charge of the crisis. Because that is a characteristic of the Socialist Party in Spain, that have the possibility to attack everybody, even the party members. Well,
okay, so we have Roland and then one from Alex. Sorry?
Okay. Yeah, I want to question really your argument. I mean, we have a rotten system, and the consequence is that it is very expensive. It is very expensive. Like the Roman Empire, you know, it was effective in the beginning, and then it became more and more expensive, so they cannot afford to keep up the system, and it broke down. And now your emphasis is on problems of transition, and this I do not understand. I mean, you made a very good point, saying what money is. It is an asset in the hands of people, and it should be. It should be given to people debt-free and circulate there. But we have a debt system, and we have this fractioned system, and which is very, very expensive. And of course, I think we need a new system. We need what money really is in the sense. It is an asset in the hands of people. Not so much emphasis on transition, but on our ready proposition to have a separate money.
Well, I am going to use the question to say this. You have a system that is worse than possible people think. My comparison is, and I used to say, because I say, well, none of the ideas when I made a presentation are mine. I mean, I read in people that is here, and so on and so on. And I compare with a Spaniard that in 1740 take a book of Montesquieu, and say Montesquieu and others, mm-hmm. No? That separation of powers is a very good thing. It's better to have a parliament, a government, a judiciary. And we had here the best of our kings, Carlos III. Charles III, that was a very illustrated king, that was an absolute king. Mm-hmm. And you are an Spaniard, I am a Spaniard, and I'm reading the book of Montesquieu, and now I was reading the book of Joseph, Professor Hilbert. Then, and what happens? Well, that is not easy to dismantle the absolutism. Mm-hmm. I mean, you had revolutions, changes, and so on and so on. Now, nobody is going to be interested in saying, well, I think that it would be a lot of synergies if we fusion government with judiciary, and why to have parliament if we could have a so on. Well, but how are you going to elect a king with the family and so on? No, nobody is going to say that. Well, most of the countries accept the separation, and this will happen. One day, I am sure that it will happen, but not tomorrow. Not tomorrow.
Roland and then Alex.
Thank you. I love this cost structure, which is hidden to most people. Because in my experience, when I criticize the present banking system, there's always somebody who pops up and says, oh, especially in the UK, the financial services is a massive industry. They pay an enormous amount of tax, this, that, and the other. And, looking at the tax they pay and looking at your as I said, hidden costs. Okay, on average, are there net costs to the taxpayer, despite the tax they're paying, because all these hidden costs, are they wiped out, in your opinion? Does it cost us actually more than what they contribute to us?
I didn't get the question, excuse me.
These are the hidden costs to the taxpayer or whoever is subsidizing the banking system we have at the moment.
This is the cost.
The cost this
without crisis.
Without crisis.
This is the cost without crisis. If you add the cost of crisis, let's suppose that there is crisis, you are spending a lot of salaries or so.
But
that you have to add the crisis that are terrible. Because are not budgetary but macro.
So we have after a year without the crisis and there's this enormous cost. But there are people who say, oh, the banks pay so much tax. They pay billions in a year of tax. And people think, oh, this is a massive gain to the economy and they have to pay less.
Yeah, that's Venus.
The question is, like, is it a net contribution?
Well, that's of course, you get the taxes. Sorry, because I was there, but it's nothing comparable.
Okay, that's all I want to do.
And the United Kingdom, that idea of financial services, there are many people, probably is one of the nations where this idea the system works very bad is more common. My colleague that was Mervyn King published a book that was called The End of Falconry, that explained that the bank deposit, the private bank deposit, are a fraud. The only question is that is a gentleman, as he said, is an alchemy. He said, well, they want to convert gold, plumbing gold, and that. And you have many important persons, like Martin Ward, has supported the magazine of personal money. And the book, The Shift and the Shocks, at the end, he explained the importance of this. And he supported the Swiss. And the economy supporters, so then there in United Kingdom is one of the countries in my view, well, I don't know other languages, the Dutch and the German probably, but relevant people is in favor, not of course like you studying and so on, but there are many people, interesting people.
So we have two final questions, Alex and then...
You said before about the different proposals, there is one thing that you said that they are very normally it's logical center in money, what should be do about money, but a bit less about what should be do about banks and banking. I assume that is for two reasons. To prevent of a big shock in the system, and also to sweeten a little the pill to the policy makers and to the decision makers to make this transition a little less fear. So could you develop a little plus this, and do you have any idea, any hint, what could we do with banks and banking in the transition or in the final to make this plus viable?
My idea is to focus on that, because I think most people is not aware of that, even in text of central bank digital money, they talk when you have the central bank digital money and the banks are not going to subsist. And then to subsist banking activities, of course, but we will provide a very different system. It's impossible. The alchemy that talks my Mervyn King, that said, by the way, in that book, that our current system is the worst of all possible systems. It's incredible. It's not, you cannot say, that argument is impossible if you allow them to the market. because nobody, how are you going to lend your money to anybody that say this is not a deposit, it's a loan, I cannot repay you, and so on, and I am going to invest in a mortgage. Then to say, well, and how much capital have you? 2%. It's impossible. You will have different intermediaries, platforms, and so on, and so on. And probably all the long-term investment will be taken by insurance and so on and so on. And, well, and the liquidity will be different, will be provided by the market and so on, and you will have different treasury letters and so on and so on. We don't know. The problem is that the status quo is important. I mean, I was president of the antitrust court in Spain, and we supported, helped the government to liberalize before transportation, communication, and so on. And my experience is that people is afraid with the market. They think that you are not going, who is going to provide a flight from Santiago to Madrid? Because now you have cross-subsidies in your national company, and if you liberalize that, we are going to lose many many provincial and regional flights. Well, the result was that the network of transportation in Spain was Madrid, Santiago, and so on, and now it's a network that goes from Girona and from other cities with low cost, because you didn't think that market would work. Because you see that it's working with a lot of things and so on, and if they take risk, and they will create other assets and so on, no? But then I cannot say what is going to happen. What I believe is that if you do that, and you liberalize, and of course re-regulate what? Protection of investors, transparency, and so on, and functioning of the market, providing infrastructures, and so on. There are many roles of the public, of the state, but not supporting a business, but supporting people. That is mainly what the securities commissions do. That is not say to the agents what they should do, but they say what they should not do.
Final question from Finland.
Actually, it is not a direct question. Maybe you can answer very easily with yes or no. But to bring it to the point, so I understand, after the small summary of Josef and your presentation, if we combine this together, I understand, like you say, guys, it is important to keep the existing banking system, and not system or banking functions somehow. But if you want to make a change, make it in two steps. First, establish your system, let's say in the existing one, and maybe in the second step you can make a whole change. Because you say, if we make it possible, the existing banks, that they ask me when I bring the money to them, to not borrow them. So if I just park the money by them, so if they give us this possibility, that is a kind of achievement for us to make our money safe. And then in the second step we can discuss either should we go to the positive money or not, or how the system should be. Do I understand well? Did I understand well? Or would you advise like this?
Well, I think that we should study the systems without talking the taxes. That's the first idea. And to see the benefits that is working in the end, and you have some money, and you have the market lending, the lending empire itself, and compare. And in my view, that is totally, well, in favor of the current system. And then study separately the transition. And in transition, I repeat, there are many ideas, but no one is for me convincing. And that's why I take more the role of a server. I don't see if this is going to be reformed, then how is going to crack the system and how is going to introduce the new ideas and of course predicting is very difficult, predicting the future.
But would a big crash maybe make a difference?
Pardon?
Would a big crash make a difference?
Well, I don't think we are going to have more people than what we have had in these last 10 years. I mean, it's incredible how we forget the damage that this crisis has done in many people. In many enterprises destroyed that you have not allowed to change and so on and so on and so on. It has been terrible. We look only at the public debt and so on, but the public debt is nothing allowed compared with the damage.
Yeah, but total debt has increased 30% from 2008. Total global debt. So a crisis is not a remote possibility, another huge crisis, because nothing has been done, actually.
You see how we are dealing, no?
Kicking yes. The can,
And then, and of course, for sure that I think that the central bankers and supervisors are studying every day how to avoid the crisis. Mm-hmm. They are not, then, and that helps. I think, in fact, that this, in the short term, has reduced the frequency of the crisis. I don't know how much, but I think that all the Basel III has helped to reduce. I think it's not enough, because you will have the flexibility. And of course, the frequency and the severity of the crisis. But.
So we all know we've got some work to do.